love the chorus of that song. Lord, you found me, you healed me, you called me from the grave. I am so thankful today. Is anybody else thankful today that he found you, that he healed you, that she called you out of a world of darkness into his marvelous light? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise as you return to your seats. Thank you so much for being here today. Thank you for your worship. You can be seated. So excited to have everybody here today with us, guests of ours that are with us. Thank you so much for joining us. Just excited about this opportunity to be able to minister the word this morning. Thank you, Pastor, for this chance. Appreciate every opportunity I get to get up here and speak to such wonderful people. I don't take it for granted. So, is it all right if I tell y'all a story? I like telling stories. So, a couple of weeks ago, Kelly, my dad, and I had a great opportunity to go on a great vacation to the Northwest. One of the days we got an opportunity to go to Montana, to Glacier National Park. Has anybody ever been to Glacier National Park in here? It's a beautiful place. It's probably one of the most beautiful places I've ever been in my life. Mountains everywhere, running water wherever you want to stop on the side of the road, falls all over the place, stuff like we have here in Louisiana. Yeah. You could truly see God's handiwork all over the place with views that would almost, Mr. Sweet, take your breath away. I got a few pictures Macy's going to throw up for me. I just want to kind of give you an idea of what I'm talking about and some of the different views here that I'm telling you that the water's blue up there too. It's not dirty brown like it is down here. And just all kinds of awesome views all over the place. That one there is, and then at the top, go ahead, Mace, that's good. It's snow. That's at the top of a road that's called Sun Road. Sun Road literally feels like you're driving up to the sun. You end up going up a side of a mountain to about 7,000 feet. And it's extremely tall. So as we're driving up Sun Road, and this road kind of winds back and forth around this mountain. If any of you have ever been on it, you know what I'm talking about. And seeing these views, and it's easy a lot of times when you look out the window to be overtaken by what you're seeing. And that's what was taking place. As we're driving, I'm in the car with Kelly, my dad, my aunt, and my uncle. We're packed in this car, and we're going up Sun Road. And in the midst of all of them talking, and it was not a quiet ride whatsoever, but in the midst of all of that talking, I begin to feel God's presence start move on me. Out of the middle of pretty much nowhere, just out in the mountains, and I get quiet, as I usually do when the Lord starts speaking to me. He starts speaking to my heart. And on the way up Sun Road, I kept hearing this word, Mike, remember. Remember. Over and over and over again in my spirit, I kept hearing, remember. Remember. And while this is happening, I start tearing up. Because, you know, when God gets a hold of you, if you're not crying, there's usually something wrong with you. But he got a hold of me, and I'm sitting there in the car, and thank God that only Kelly was the only one that realized something was up. She didn't know what was up, but my aunt and uncle and my dad are just chatting away and not paying attention to me, because that car ride would have turned into, oh, my Lord God, what is wrong with Tommy right now? And so thankfully, Kelly seen this. She left me alone like a good wife at that time. She left me alone. And so when we get to almost to the top, I'm trying to figure out, what in the world, Lord, are you talking to me? So we get to the top, and there's this visitor center, and I walk off by myself, and I'm looking out over this, and I see snow all over the place. And the Lord spoke to me again, and he said, remember who you are and whose you are. Remember who you are and whose you are. And he kept telling me that over and over and over. And then I understood what he was saying to me. Without going into much detail, I've preached about it. I've talked about it. Last year, it stunk at a lot of levels for me and my family and things, losing my mom and everything else that has taken place. And at some point over that, I've allowed everything that has taken place to cause me to forget who I was and whose I was. And hear me, because of that, I wasn't fully operating in the mission and the purpose that God had created me for. I was existing, but I wasn't thriving. I was going through life, but I wasn't prospering through life. Ephesians 2 and 10 says this, "For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago." He had a plan for you before you even took your first breath. And the same goes for me. So right after the Lord elaborated on what he was telling me, the craziest thing happened. We're listening to the K-Love Christian radio station, and we're going back down the mountain. And all of a sudden, after he spoke this to me, there is a devotion that comes on from a story that I'm pretty sure almost probably everyone in here knows this story. And so, Macy, if you don't mind throwing that music on, this is where the story came from. The kids are laughing. If you don't know, you can cut it. That music is from The Lion King. The story was The Lion King, and that's where I want to talk about a little bit this morning, about The Lion King for just a second. The young lion in the story is named Simba, and he is the son of King Mufasa. And I mean, I get to preach like the coolest Disney movie. I mean, that's fun. So studying was watching The Lion King again, so that was fun too. Simba, at the beginning, just can't wait to be king. But something takes place, for time's sake, I'm going to go quickly, that forever changed his life. Mufasa, his dad, is killed by his uncle Scar. But Scar convinces Simba that he did it. So in all of that, Simba runs until he ends up in another jungle where he meets two friends named Timon and Pumbaa. And they start living a life of Hakuna Matata, which means no worries for the rest of your days. But in the midst of saying he's living with no worries, Simba is bound by shame and guilt, and he forgets who he really is. One night, Simba, Timon, and Pumbaa are looking up at the stars, wanting to know what they are. Simba tells them that he was told that those stars were great old kings of the past. Timon and Pumbaa laugh it off, and Simba still goes away feeling ashamed. A little while later, Simba runs into Rafiki, which is the baboon. And Rafiki tells Simba he knows who he is. He takes him to a reflective pool. He looks down and he sees himself and he says, "No, look further." And he looks down again and Simba sees the image of his father. Rafiki tells Simba that Mufasa lives within him, and then Mufasa out of nowhere appears in the clouds. Mufasa tells Simba that, "Simba, you have forgotten who you are, and because of that, you have forgotten me." Mufasa says something next that gave me the title to my message. He tells Simba, he says, "Simba, look inside yourself. You are more than what you've become. You are more than what you've become." He ends by saying, "Simba, remember who you are. You are my son." So the title of my message today is Made for More. Made for More. When God created us, He didn't just create us to exist and go through the motions of life. God created us in his image for a purpose, as I've stated. Psalms 139:14 says, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. I always like the wording of that verse, fearfully and wonderfully made. I think that's incredible. We're fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of God. That sounds amazing to all of us, I'm sure. But if we were being honest this morning, do you actually feel like you're fearfully and wonderfully made today? Or do you feel something else about yourself? If I were to ask you a simple question today of who are you, what would be your answer? Not what everybody else sees, not the image that you portray on social media. Who are you really? Why does it matter? Why does it matter who you think you are? Because your purpose is directly tied to your identity. And if you don't know who you are, you can't fulfill the purpose that God planned for you long ago. You can't fulfill the purpose God set aside for you until you know who you are and whose you are. So if your identity is that important, where do you think the enemy is going to attack? Your identity. And that's what he did in this most probably famous story, of one of the more famous stories of the Bible, in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. Let's look at it. Genesis 3, 1 through 5 says, the serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any trees in the garden? Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, the woman replied. It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die. You won't die, the serpent replied to the woman. God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. I want us to understand something this morning. Adam and Eve were already like God because they were created in his image. The devil got them to question their identity by telling them lies, and they bought into them. He got them to believe by eating that fruit they could become something that they already were, which was like God. The fall of man happened when man got confused and tricked about his/her identity. So hear me this morning. Every time we allow the enemy to confuse us about our identity, a fall is coming soon after. A fall is coming soon after. You forget who you are and whose you are. And when that happens, you start living beneath the life and the purpose that God created you for. God created Adam and Eve to stay in the Garden of Eden. It was never his plan for them to leave. But when they forgot who they were, a fall took place. They started living beneath their purpose. They had to be kicked out of the place that they were supposed to be in forever. Yeah. Yeah. So let me ask you this morning, because I want you to get this. The devil is the father of lies and the author of confusion. The word says that God is not the author of confusion, which means the devil is the author of confusion. You want to know why there's so much confusion in the world about gender, about identity? Boys think they're girls, girls think they're guys. They don't know what's going on. It's because the devil is the author of confusion. And he's confusing this entire world about who they are and whose they are. And my fear is he's just not got the world, but it's creeped into the church. We have forgotten who we are and whose we are. We've accepted lies of the enemy to confuse us. So let me ask you, what lies have you been believing and accepted as truth that the enemy has told you about yourself? How about things like you're unlovable, you're addicted, you're a failure, you're broken, you're hopeless, you're a mistake waiting to happen. You'll never measure up. You'll never be good enough. You'll never be talented enough. You'll never be smart enough. You can't be used of God because of what you did in your past. It would be better if I was somebody else, if I had their life and their identity. So let me ask you, what lies have you accepted as truth about yourself? So where, oh, where do we find the truth about ourselves? If you find the truth anywhere else but here, it's a lie. It's a lie. The only place, the only real place that you can find the real you is in the real Word of God. Nowhere else. This is the only place that you can find out who you are and whose you are. And if you find out your identity, you'll follow in your purpose. So I'm calling on someone today to remember. Remember who you are. We get our identity from God's word. Verses like this one, 1 Peter 2 and 9 and 10 in the NLT. But you are not like that. For you are a chosen people. You're a royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God. For he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Now, I've quoted this scripture many times. I have preached this scripture many times. But look at the next verse. Once you had no identity as a people. But now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. Once you had no identity, but that's not who you are anymore. If you've been blood bought, if you've been baptized in the name of Jesus, if you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, if that same resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead has raised you from the dead spiritually, then you are who God says you are. Galatians 4 and 7, now you are no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you are his child, God has made you heir. 1 John 3 and 1, see how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children, and that is what we are. Romans 5 and 1 says, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Not only are we his child, we've been made right in God's sight. Romans 8 and 1 says, now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. So if you don't know who you are, let me help you today. These are just a few verses. There's so many more in the Word. I just don't have time to give them to you this morning. But if I was to summarize who you are this morning, I'm going to help you out a little bit. You're a child of God. You're not condemned but forgiven. You are free. You are healed. You are holy. You are chosen. You're anointed. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. You are victorious. You are more than a conqueror. You are God's masterpiece. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. You are so much more than what the world and the enemy has been telling you. That's who you are. But we must not forget as well whose we are. Whose we are. Who do we belong to? Isaiah 40, 28 through 29, have you never heard? Have you never understood? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all the earth. He never grows weak or weary. No one can measure the depths of his understanding. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. I love that verse. Deuteronomy 10:17. For the Lord your God is the God of gods and the Lord of lords. He is the great God, the mighty and awesome God, who shows no partiality and cannot be bribed. Let's keep going. Psalms 86, 8 through 10. No pagan God is like you, O Lord. None can do what you can do. All the nations you made will come and bow before you, Lord. They will praise your holy name, for you are great and perform wonderful deeds. You alone are God. Psalm 66 and 3, I thought this one was kind of cool. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. Your enemies cringe before your mighty power. I like that. Your enemies cringe before your mighty power. Isaiah 40, 25 through 26, to whom will you compare me? Who is my equal as the Holy One? Look up in the heavens. Who created the stars? He brings them out like an army, one after another, calling each by its name. Because of his great power and incomparable strength, not a single one is missing. How about this one? We quote this one a lot. We like this one. Isaiah 43, 1 through 3. But now, O Jacob, listen to the Lord God who created you. O Israel, the one who formed you says, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. Be like the three Hebrew boys that walked out of the fire and their clothes didn't even smell like smoke. So, whose are we? Again, I wish I had time to read every verse there was about how great God is, but I don't have that time. But if I were to summarize him, which is difficult, but it's fun. We belong to the omnipresent, which means ever-present, omniscient, which means all-knowing, omnipotent, which means all-powerful God, the God who has, Pastor, no beginning and he has no end, the creator of all things, the God whose greatness is immeasurable, whose understanding is unmatched. He can't be defeated. He can't fail. He can't lie, because everything he speaks is truth. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the great I am, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, the healer that makes all things new, and the Savior of the world. Whose are you? You belong to Jesus Christ, name above all names, worthy of all praise, the one who came to seek and to save that which was lost, the one that defeated death, hell, and the grave. The one whose blood has washed you clean from all your sin, whose stripes on his back has healed you. That's who you belong to. That's who you are. That's whose you are. Remember who you are and whose you are. And when that happens, you will live out your purpose to make a difference in this world for his kingdom. But so many people allow the enemy to make you settle for less when you were made for more. Don't allow shame, guilt, fear, worry, or anything else to cause you to settle for less when there's more for you. Hear me, there's more for you. There's more for you than a life ruled by fear, depression, and anxiety. There's more for you than a life ruled by sickness and disease. There's more for you than a life ruled by poverty and hurt and pain. There's more for you than what you have settled for. You got to remember. You got to go back in your mind. You got to remember when Jesus forgave you, when you were baptized in his name, when you were filled with the Holy Ghost. Remember where he brought you from to where you are now. There's more for you. There's more for you. Adam and Eve, unfortunately for all of us, settled for less. And all of us are paying the price for that decision. But you know, there are countless other people in the Bible that didn't settle for less, that knew they were made for more. Let's talk about a few. Abraham could have stayed in the land of his father, but he knew God had made him for more. And he said, everywhere that you walk, Abraham, everywhere you put your feet, that's going to be your descendants' land. That's going to be yours. He knew he was made for more. Joseph could have given in to Potiphar's wife. But Joseph knew, God gave me a dream. God spoke to me. I was made more. I was made for more than just this temporary pleasure. I was made for more than just giving into this. Moses went on the run out of Egypt, ended up in Midian for 40 years. Ended up marrying a woman, having a child. Moses could have stayed in Midian, but he had a burning bush experience. And God said, wait a minute, this isn't where you were meant to be. I got you a purpose, and I need you to leave where you are, and I need you to go, and you tell Pharaoh to let my people go, and I will be with you, and you will lead my people out of the land of Egypt, out of their bondage and their slavery. Moses was confused. Moses didn't know what to do, but Moses allowed the Lord to tell him what to do, and he did it. As reluctant as he was at first, he still did it. He knew he was made for more. David could have stayed on the sidelines when he walked up and Goliath had already been there 40 days taunting the nation of Israel. His brothers were there. He could have stayed there in fear, in worry. But he looked at them and he said, is there not a cause? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that is coming against the armies of God? Who is this that is declaring he's going to defeat us? No, we are God's chosen people. And David walked out on there and he said, you know what? God was with me when I killed the bear. He was with me when I killed the lion. He's going to be with me in this giant. And he walked out on that battlefield and he slung that stone and he cut Goliath's head off and he won the victory for the entire nation of Israel. He could have stayed on the sidelines, but he knew he was made for more. Daniel, when the king said, hey, nobody can pray except to me. Nobody can make a request except to me. No, he was tricked into that, but that's what took place. He signs a decree. And in the midst of that decree, Daniel could have went home, shut all the windows, and got under his bed and then made a prayer. Well, he went to the window, opened it, and was like, hey, if you want to know, I'm praying up here, I'm praying up here. And he prayed. Why? Because he knew God had made him for more. Let's talk about somebody that all of us love more than anything. Jesus. Jesus is taken out into the wilderness, and Satan tempts him 3 times. One of the times he takes him up to a high height and he shows him all the kingdoms of the world. And he says, hey, if you'll bow down to me, then you can have all of this. In that moment, if Jesus would have bowed, he would have settled for earthly kingdoms, but he wasn't here to build an earthly kingdom. He was here to build a heavenly one, an eternal one, one that will last forever. For kingdoms of this earth will come and they will go, but the kingdom of God will last for all of eternity. So Jesus knew he was made for more. He knew his purpose was for more. He knew he came to this earth to seek and to save that which was lost, and he couldn't do that if he'd have given in to what the enemy was offering him. So what did he say? And this is how you defeat the enemy. Whenever he comes and starts telling you lies, he says, "Thus saith the word of God." What's the word say? Man shall live by bread alone. Not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. You combat the lies and the confusion with that, with the word of God. There's so many more that I could bring up. Peter could have given up, walked away when he denied Jesus 3 times, but he knew he was made for more. Paul, when he was Saul, could have never given in and done what he did, but he knew he was made for more. So my message for you this morning is stop settling for less when God made you for more. Stop settling for less when God made you for more. Stop settling for less when God made you for more. I don't care what the world says about you. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what the people say. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us have made mistakes. But oh, if you found that place of repentance, if you have found that place where God saved you and forgave you, you don't have to hold your head down in shame and guilt or in anything else. For when he filled you with the Spirit, when you were baptized in his name, you took that name on and you became his child. You don't have to walk around with your head down. You don't have to put your fear and worry into action every single day in your life. But you can be bold in your identity and you can be bold in your purpose. Look at this verse that I found that I thought just was pretty interesting. Proverbs 28:1, we're reading Proverbs. The wicked run away when no one is chasing them, but the godly are as bold as lions. The wicked run away when no one is chasing them. That's what shame and guilt will do to you, because look, what was the first thing that Adam and Eve did after they realized they sinned? They ran and hid. Who was chasing them? Nobody. Nobody. Now, the Lord came looking for them later, but he wasn't chasing after them. And I feel this in my spirit when I read it the other night, and I feel it right now, that there are many in here that are running away from something that's not even chasing you. You're running away from things that you've done, things that have taken place many years ago, and you're running away from shame and guilt, and there is nothing chasing you. There's not a God that's running with vengeance and punishment and condemnation to come take you out, because people have preached that and people have said that, and they've portrayed God as a mean person and a mean God that'll just take you out at every little mistake that you made. But Paul tells us in Romans, where sin abounds, grace abounds that much more. That much more. Stop settling for less. Stop running away from things that aren't even chasing you. And be as bold as a lion. Time to get out of the pit. It's time to get out of that grave that we've been hanging around in. It's time to get out of that prison that we've allowed the enemy to put us in. It's time to stop running from things that aren't even chasing us And it's time to remember who we are and whose we are. Simba was made for more. He was made for more. We know the story. He comes back, defeats his uncle, and takes his rightful place as king. So you got a choice this morning. Are you going to keep hanging out in a land that you were never destined to be in? Are you going to come back to who you are and whose you are and defeat the enemy and shut him up? Because there is another verse in the Word about a lion. He is a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But I want you to get something here. A roaring lion is not a biting lion. He's loud, but he can't do nothing to you. So how do we shut him up this morning? We start declaring this over our lives. I'm more than a conqueror. I'm healed in Jesus' name. I'm victorious. I'll overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of my testimony. I'm blessed going in. I'm blessed going out. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the country. Everything I put my hands on is going to be blessed because I'm a child of God. His royal blood flows through my veins. He called me out of darkness into marvelous light. I'm not who I used to be, but no things are passed away, and he made all things new. I'm a new creature in Christ. I'm healed in Jesus' name. I'm free in Jesus' name. I'm whole in Jesus' name. I'm restored in Jesus' name. I'm above and not beneath. I'm the head and not the tail. I'm not broken. I'm not defeated. I'm not bound. I am a child of God. That's who I am. That's who you are. Why don't you stand to your feet right now? And I want you to get bold right now, bold as a lion. This isn't one of those kind of messages where you come to the altar and you cry. This is one of those kind of messages where you boldly approach the throne of grace. Boldly approach the throne of grace to obtain mercy in your time of need. That's what we need to do right now. We don't need to come down here and cry about past mistakes. It's been forgiven. It's under the blood. Quit repenting about something that's already been forgiven. God's forgotten it. God is letting it go. It's time for you to let it go. It's time for you to step out into your identity, step out in your purpose, and be who God's called you to be. You are made for more. Don't settle for less. You are made for more. Come on, somebody. Come on, get loud. Let the enemy know. I'm not allowing shame and guilt to hold me down anymore. I know who I am. I know whose I am.
Cross of salvation was only the start. Now I am chosen, free and forgiven. I have a future, and it's worth the living. 'Cause I wasn't made to be tending a grave.
Come on, somebody, proclaim it right now. Proclaim that word of God right now over your life. Come on. Get hanging your head because of what happened yesterday. Today is a new day. Hallelujah.
Why would I make a bed in my shame when a fountain of grace is running my way? I know I am yours, and I was made for more. I know who I am. Yeah.
myself.
So why would I make a bed in my shame when a fountain of grace is running my way? I know I am yours, and I was made for more.
Yeah.
I know who I am, 'cause I know who you are. The cross of salvation was only the start. Now I am chosen, free and forgiven. I have.
If the devil can get us to think less of ourselves, right? If the devil can make us think less, if the devil can put thoughts in our minds that we're not really that, if the devil can make us feel like we're useless, if the devil can make you and I feel like that we're washed up, right? Anybody ever feel like you've done too many sins? You ever thought like I've gone too far? Let me tell you something. That's a trick of the devil. The cross went to the deepest part of sin to save you and I from a wretched life and to give us hope and grace. Do you understand that His grace and mercy is renewed every day? Here's what I want you to do, because it's the devil's business to make you and I think I'm just not. It's the devil's business to make you and I think it's for everybody. Can I tell you today, it's for you. It's for you. Somebody better hear me. It's for you. God loves you. God cares for you. And God's got more for you. Where sin does abide, grace and mercy. More. Abide. That's what it says. It says more. You know what He wants you to know? Is that I can't go too far where God don't have more mercy to pull me back. I don't know who's here today that needed this, but Pastor Tommy preached a message to somebody today. And somebody needs to remember, God knows where you are, and God sees where you're at, and God understands what you're up against. But you got to remember that you're a child of the King. Come on, somebody. You're a child of God. His royal blood flows through you. So here's what I want you to do. Because it's easy to come to an altar and say a few Hail Marys and turn around and go home and be the same individual. But I believe right now God's wanting to break somebody into a new place. I believe God's wanting to break somebody into a new realm. I believe God's wanting to tear down some walls right now. Tear down some doubt and some fear and some unbelief right now. And say, I do have more for you. Would you raise your hands right now? Come on. Would you lift your voice right now? And come on, all over this house, would you begin to let God know, God, here I am. Here I am, Lord. Use me. God, I want you to do the work. I want you to do the miracle. I want you to touch me with the touch of grace right now. I'm asking you right now, God, to do what only you can do in my spirit and in my soul. God, I'm asking you right now for the presence of your spirit. For your presence right now, God, to sweep over this auditorium. God, I'm asking you right now to minister to our hearts. Minister to our spirits, God. Minister to each and every one of us right now. God, I pray right now that we would remember whose we are. Who we are. We are a child of yours. And God, I pray right now for a divine move. Oh, somebody open up your spirit right now. Come on, somebody open up your heart right now. Come on, let God touch you right now. In the name of Jesus right now, God. Break those chains. Break those barriers. Break those strongholds right now. And God, I pray that you would set us free this very moment. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Come on, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Come on, let's let Thanksgiving begin to roll right now. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Come on, that's right, all over this house. I thank you, Lord, for your blood. I thank you for your grace, God. I thank you for your mercy, God. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for your renewing power. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. What an awesome God, right? What a mighty God, right? Amen, amen. I want you to go this week, and I want you to remember whose you are. All right? I want you to remember who you are. Listen, I'm not just James Manning. I'm a child of the King. You know, if I have a boy for a grandson, Macy rather has the boy, not me. That'd be a miracle, I'm going to tell you now. But his middle name is going to be Mitchell. My great-great-grandpa was Mitchell. My grandpa was Mitchell. My dad is Mitchell. I'm Mitchell. Chase is Mitchell. There's something about the name Mitchell in our family. I'm going to tell you something. That name Mitchell can't save you. But there is a name that is above every name, and that name has been applied unto your life. Do you understand that name has been applied unto your life, and it gets applied unto your life at water baptism? And we're getting ready to baptize too in the lovely name of Jesus. I want you to leave this house today remembering who I am. This is what the Bible says. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against it. Do you know what else it says? No weapon formed against me no weapon, right, shall form against me. It doesn't say it won't be formed. But when the enemy does form it, guess what? It's not going to prosper. It's not going to prosper. You are a child of God. If you'll give me some house lights, you're a child of God. And I want you to leave this house today realizing who I am, right? Realizing who I am, correct? Come on, let's say it together. I am a child of God. Now, I want you to say it like you mean it. I am a child of God. In Jesus' name, would you give the Lord a great big hand clap of praise? Come on, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you want to just fellowship for a moment while they're getting ready, we would love for you to stay for baptism. God bless you.